Welcome, everybody, to the February 10th board meeting of the Granville Exempted Village School District. Thank you for being here this evening. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we take the roll, please?
Dr. Vernon.
Here.
Ms. Dean.
Here.
Mr. Janice.
Here.
Mr. Miller.
Here.
Come again.
Thank you very much. So our first congregation tonight is our young man sitting in the front row with a very big smile on his face. We are recognizing third grade student Jacob Teeter for achieving a perfect score on the Fall Ohio Achievement Assessment Test for Reading. Jacob's reading achievement is significant because less than 1% of all students in the state attain a perfect score on this test by the end of third grade. Jacob not only achieved this, he did this at the start of the school year. It's the one assessment that we give at the beginning of the school year. So please join me in recognizing Jacob Teeter for his perfect score.
Thank you.
What's
your certificate?
So I guess that's going to be on Facebook in and out. Next, I'd like to recognize our Granville art teachers, Sarah Schimmel, Michelle Day, Amanda Tucker, and Vonda McDonald, for embracing the values of leadership and service as demonstrated by Martin Luther King Jr. These educators work together with the Feed the Dream Community Committee to bring Dr. King's teachings to their classroom. The students develop creative works based on the theme inspired by the dream. All works were then put on display at an art show which ran on the Sunday prior to Martin Luther King Jr.'s holiday. These incredible pieces sparked much emotion and praise from visitors to the show. The artwork was also used as part of Denison University's Martin Luther King celebration the following weekend. We honor these four educators who brought meaning and honor to King's legacy through creative instruction in their classrooms. So I think we have Michelle and Amanda here tonight. So please come on up. I actually got to roll tape for Mrs. Day, and I think my fingers were still cracky the next day. So. I did, didn't I? I took direction. We good? All right, great. Thank you very much. I'm hoping that becomes a tradition that we can continue, because I was very impressed with the artwork of the students. I mean, literally, there were pieces of art that brought people to tears. So that was a really cool experience. So thank you. And that concludes my commendations. At this point, if you're not here for the rest of the meeting, you will not hurt our feelings if you have to go do homework, get kids to bed, or whatever. So thank you. But you're welcome to stay.
What?
Thank you.
Take the opportunity now.
Staff report?
Yes. Okay. I'd like to invite Dr. Fry and our building administrators up to the podium. But before, while Tom's getting set up, let me just start by talking a little bit about what we're doing. We're giving you an update on the current continuous improvement plan and professional development that's been taking place in all four buildings. My orientation is that continuous improvement is a hallmark of an excellent organization. If you don't have that orientation or mentality, it's very easy to regress to the mean or be complacent with your results. And I think one of the things that I've been very excited about in Granville is that notion of continuous improvement and that asking the difficult questions about what are we doing really well and what are we needing to improve upon. And I think that helps the organization move forward. When it comes to professional development, that's all about building capacity of teachers, administrators, central office staff, about what best practices are and how can we deliver instruction that is high quality and meets the needs of the students of Granville. So with that, I've hopefully set the stage for Dr. Fry and the rest of the group. And I was supposed to stall a little bit longer because Ms. Stormon's on her way.
There she is.
Thank you. Use the razor to tell jokes. Oh, we won. All right,
excellent. Well, thank you, Mr. Brown. And so we really want to talk about the Building Continuous Improvement Plans, or CIPs, and who better than the principals to share those. Just real quickly, I want to give you just a sense of the kind of things you're going to see on the CIPs. They're all on the district website under the curriculum and instruction link, so you should be able to find all those. But you'll notice that at the top of each of the building CIPs, there'll be a list of those things that the building is doing well and how we know it, and then there'll be the areas for improvement or the things that we think we still need to see some improvement on. And so the building principal will talk a little bit about that today. And then the next piece that they're going to spend a lot of time on is really sort of the district initiative and what that looks like in their building. And those will probably be more like stories about the things that are happening. And then also the building initiatives, because within each building, they'll have their own specific initiatives that they'll be working on based on their specific data that they have. So just to give that context, I'll now turn it over to
all right, GHS, we identified these areas of strength at the top here that we had above growth in all the OGT subjects last year and 9 of the 11, and of course exams, and the two that we didn't, we had expected growth. 70% of our students scored a 3 or better on the AP test. A 3 is kind of a significant number in terms of, in Ohio, if you go to a public school and get a 3 or better on an AP test, a public college, I should say, you get automatic college credit for that particular course. And most private schools follow suit with that as well. Some will be a little more, have a little higher expectations of having a 4 or 5, but most will stick to that 3 to give college credit. And 85% of students were involved in an extra co-curricular activity last year. And some areas of growth, and one of the things that we do as department chairs in the spring and into the summer is looking at all this data, what are the areas that we really need to work on? So one of the things that we identified right off the bat was every year we are given data on students who scored college ready on the ACT. It was 60% from the previous year, which isn't that great, but the national average is in the 20s, I think, or in Ohio's average was 28%, and nationally it was below that. So that number is very hard to attain. 60 was actually a very good score. It went down to 51% last year. That was an immediate red flag for the staff. Increase the number of students taking AP courses and scoring 3 or above. Those two things are hard to do in tandem. If you have more kids taking the test, the average tends to go down. So to increase the number and at least maintain the percentage that's scoring a 3 or higher is a challenge. But that's something we identified. We want more kids taking advantage of those courses. And then increase formative assessment usage, which is right in line with the district initiatives. So overall, in our building, the district goal, increased student ownership of learning through use of high leverage structures, and then each department came up with last spring a goal that they wanted to work on based on the data that they had received as of April and May of last year, and something that we've done every single year. And you'll notice that if you look down through the departments, there's this common theme of, that goes back to our district PD of student ownership of learning, and formative assessment. You just kind of see that ring true in all of these, and I'll point out a couple in particular, a couple departments and what they're doing and what these different things mean. I'll start with math, student self-assessment rubrics. Self-assessment is not something that takes place in a lot of traditional math classrooms, and it's the place where it probably should take place the most. Students in math can learn so much more from the mistakes that they've made and assessing that as in doing it right the first time. So different classes have developed different strategies. Some do it every quarter, some do it after every single test, in terms of these are the goals for our next unit and how are you going to assess your growth over the course of the next unit. So they're really goal setting and assessing the work that they've done. So if you didn't get the achievement level that you wanted, which the kids relate to a grade, you know, what are you going to do the next quarter? Well, I'm going to come in for some help sessions with the teacher. I'm going to spend some time, more time at home working. And at the end of that quarter, end of that unit, did you actually do those things and did you see a benefit? And this amazing thing happens with high school students is they spend a little more time doing their homework, or they do it in the first place. They get a little extra help from their teachers, and magically they reach their goals. It's an enlightening moment for a lot of our students. Said a little tongue-in-cheek there. The English department, calibration of writing standards with our special education department. So what they're doing there is they're taking student essays that were hot off the presses, so to speak, and projecting them up on the wall, and then they're reading them silently and grading them, and then saying, okay, I gave this paper an 82, I gave this paper a 78. Well, why'd you give it a 78 and I gave it an 82? They've already done that within the English department. Now they're bringing the special education department in there so they can help assess students with special needs and give them the feedback that they would get from their English class classrooms as well. So that's been something they've been working on quite a bit. It takes a lot of time to calibrate. That's a very subjective process going through the writing process, and the social studies department is doing something very similar to that. So that they're all similar, it's impossible to be exact, but at least similar in terms of their expectations, and are those expectations at a high enough level. And then one other one I wanted to talk a little bit about was the technology. Evaluate My Big Campus as a learning management system. If you have a high school student, you've heard of Moodle. If you haven't, I'm sure you've heard of Moodle at some point that we've talked about. Moodle has been a great tool for us in the classroom. We started with PID where you could just post assignments. We wanted to do more than that. Moodle definitely filled a gap, and now Moodle's not enough for a lot of things that our staff wants to do. So we have three teachers that have piloted My Big Campus this year and absolutely have fallen in love with it, so much to the point where now the other teachers are asking, when are they going to learn how to use it? So we're going to slowly, gradually implement My Big Campus starting this spring, actually, for next school year. It's just a way that teachers can make bundles for each unit that has all kinds of information, not just due dates and papers, but access to outside resources. All those things, when you look at them, giving students more ownership of their learning, giving students more, more involved in the process of assessing their own learning, all going back to those high level strategies that increase student achievement. Hand it off to these.
Trying to find different tune out after a while, and when they hear the word bullying, they really start to tune you out. So the guidance, our guidance counselor, Misty Postal, came across this group, the 12 Rachel's Challenge, a nonprofit organization. And Rachel, unfortunately, was the first person that was shot and killed in Colorado. And her family started this organization. And in a nutshell, it's basically simple, small acts of kindness. So we were able to get the money together to have them come in the fall. And then we started our own floor club, which is called Friends of Rachel. And Mrs. Postal is in charge of that. They meet every Friday for about 20 to 25 minutes. And it's a very strong, active group so far. Every week we've had everywhere from 60 to 75 kids per week. And they're trying to do different weekly activities to help promote this. We've also written a grant, NBC, Channel 4, the Making a Difference grant. We've applied for one of those so that we can continue on with Rachel's Challenge in the future, possibly, because they have different levels if they continue to come back, so that hopefully we can be supported that way. So that's one thing we're working on. Another idea that we're trying to work with staff is we have to recognize that everyone brings something different to the table, a different strength. So we're trying to tap into what those different strengths are among our staff members. So once a month at the different team meetings, we're having a different staff member present to the others, and we're trying to keep it all centered around technology, but how can it be a tool for the teacher to differentiate the lessons so that we're reaching the kids at their level? So for instance, some of the previous months have been, our librarian has done a really nice job of showing the teachers just how valuable Info Ohio is. I'm sure you're familiar with that too. And sharing with the teachers different apps. The most common one that the teachers are really enjoying right now is Mozilla. And you can research, or you can search, I should say, by content, so whatever your content may be for your subject area, and reading level, and it's all nonfiction. And so, and that typically is an area where some of the kids struggle with nonfiction reading. So you can find something on your topic at a lower reading level for certain kids in your class. For instance, this month, February, I have a couple teachers that are presenting on, like Mr. Bernack can say, My Big Canvas. I have at least a half a dozen teachers who are really taken off with using My Big Canvas because it looks very much like a social network, like Facebook. And she, the science department specifically, and one teacher, has really found a way to use this as a tool to individualize instruction. And she has it all set up and prepared for them before, but when they log on to their account, everything is geared towards what they need, and each student can have something different. And you can set up assessments on there, it'll give you an item analysis. It's a really valuable tool and a time saver for teachers as well. So those are just some of the things that we're doing each month to try to encourage teachers to take those back to their classroom and utilize those to work with students.
Thank you.
Good evening. So here are some of the things that are taking place at GIS. We are, the top three bullets that you see, those are things that were, we identified as strengths for us. Last year, through our student survey, we were able to increase the number of students who felt that they had a staff member that they could go to that was cared for them, not only just academically, but social emotionally as well. So we were excited to see that that increased from 89% the previous year to 93% last year. And then you'll see we're still working on that, because our goal is we would like to see that get to at least 95%, if not 100%. We earned an A for our student growth. And then through our teacher collaboration days, we do an Essential Tuesday, not every Tuesday, but typically two Tuesdays a month where teachers have anywhere from an hour to an hour and a half in the morning to do collaboration and plan with curriculum, unpacking Common Core, writing learning targets to meet the new standards, and also to tie in with the whole student ownership of learning so the students know exactly what it is that they're working on. Some of the things that we're working on this school year is, although we earned a C and our lowest 20% of students that showed a year's worth of growth, we're hoping to increase that to at least a B this coming school year. We also want to increase our number of students that are scoring at the highest levels, those advanced and accelerated. Currently, we have 66% of our population scoring at that level, so we would like to see that increase. And then we started a character ed program to tie in with the student relationship piece. So we're continuing have a character ed committee that has the last bullet there. I'll just kind of keep talking about that. That has created what we're calling a MIC. And a MIC stands for My Inside Connection. And Tammy Braymeyer is going into classes and she's talking about relationships and talking about some ways that students can approach teachers in a more comfortable level, teachers approaching students in a more comfortable level. And so each student is doing a kind of like a graphic organizer, and they are picking one adult in the building that they feel comfortable going to, and they're writing different characteristics about that adult as to why they feel comfortable going to that adult. And then they're writing a letter to that adult, and then they're posting that up on My Big Campus, and we now are kind of one big social network within the building with My Big Campus, because the kids are now sending emails to adults asking them to be a follower on My Big Campus. So for example, like today I had 8 different emails from students that are asking me to follow them on My Big Campus, and they're asking to allow to follow me on My Big Campus. So we'll be exchanging letters and that type of thing for the mics. And it's really kind of cute. I mean, the letters that are coming through, it's really kind of put a more positive spin in the air, because the teachers are getting letters and they're not realizing, wow, the student really recognized that about me. So it's really kind of cute that it's taking place. So with the whole student ownership of learning, with the district initiative, we had a couple early releases at the beginning of the year that my team leaders and I introduced the whole initiative around student ownership, and then we took it off where we identified some people in the building that had some real strengths in setting goals with students, or some real strengths with how can I have a student do a self-assessment in science? How can I have them do that in social studies? And so we identified some of those, and then at another early release, we brought all of that together. I assigned them to groups, and it was cross grade level, and they sat and just had really good discussion around, okay, this is a tool I could use for self-assessment, but in my class I could tweak it this way, or I could do this. And now we, at grade level meetings, will be coming back to the table to actually show examples of student work of where that, how that fit into it. The other thing, in order to meet those goals around the lowest 20%, and getting students to really score at those advanced and accelerated levels, we're doing a huge push with differentiation of instruction in the building. So I identified some experts within the building that I feel are doing a really, really good job with differentiation, and not just in reading language arts, because that seems like the place that it's much easier to do. So I also identified teachers in science, social studies, and math. And then at a staff meeting, I asked those experts to come prepared with examples of student work and lessons that they differentiated. And then the people that still were not feeling like they were doing a very good job of that, I asked them to bring a lesson with them that they wanted help in differentiating. And I did all that through a self-assessment, because I'm trying to model some of those things with staff so that they see how it works between us, so that it then can trickle down to students. So that's how I chose my experts, was through that self-assessment. And it really turned into a great discussion around differentiation, that the experts were sharing how they differentiated, and then they were giving tips, and it just kind of turned into a nice little round table discussion, and they were cross grade level in that activity as well. So differentiation in the building has really, really improved. People are coming to a better comfort level around it, and so we're seeing some great things going on. If you're in the classroom, you might see this group doing this and this group doing this. So it has really, really kind of taken off in the building. The other thing that's new for us are maps, because this is our first year using maps, so we're doing it in reading a map, and that's another way that we're meeting the student ownership piece, because there is a goal setting piece with maps. So we're starting to, now that we've had our fall administration and our winter administration, teachers are looking at what the projected growth is for the entire year, seeing that they met that, and then they're looking at the different strands within MAPS to see which ones are strengths for students, which ones are areas for improvement, and then they're sitting and having one-on-one conferences with students to actually set goals with the student around their MAP results. So that's in a nutshell what's happening at GIS.
Mr. Rogers sends his apologies. He couldn't be here tonight, so I'll be filling in, obviously. So some of the strengths at GES, we've met all the state indicators last year, and our student exit survey has some very positive responses. 88% of our students feel safe, and 92% feel they're challenged on a daily basis at school, and 97% of our kids feel like there's someone, an adult in the building who really cares about them, which I think is extremely positive. And we also increased the percentage of students who are just demonstrating growth in math and reading. So obviously when we came up with our CIP, we wanted to kind of continue to build on this and continue to make progress. And so what I think you'll see through these goals is kind of that same rationale and the flow, the same thread there. I want to start off talking about PACS and ACE Day. If you don't know what PACS is, it's kind of a behavioral management system, but it's one that we utilize building-wide. It just creates a common language, and it creates a teaming atmosphere and creates harmony in the building. And so for me, coming in new to GES, it was wonderful to come in and just, I could just tell a student, you know, I want to see some really positive PACS behavior, and they knew exactly what I was talking about. And I knew exactly what to look for when I saw that, and I could easily give accolades to children and students because they were doing, they knew what to do. And every classroom uses PACS now. Teachers have gone through training, and as new teachers come in, we'll provide more training for them. And if you walk into GES and you blow your harmonica, that place will go quiet. Because they know exactly what to do. It's really awesome to see. ACE Day, if you don't know what ACE Day is, every Wednesday we have an hour where the teachers can have time to collaborate, which is amazing for them. But in that hour, the students come together and we have different activities. This year we've had a local dog trainer come and provide an amazing presentation of different skill sets. We've had folk dancers come in and provide a demonstration there. We actually had our third grade performance. The third graders demonstrated their performance in the fall, and the first and second graders got to see that, got to see what to look forward to. This Wednesday, we actually are having Arnett Howard, if you know, the jazz musician, coming in. He'll be performing. In the spring, we have a mime who's coming to kind of talk to the kids. So we're really allowing them. We actually will talk to the kids about mining. But it really does allow them to kind of explore other avenues and kind of expand their cultural awareness of things that they might not necessarily have experienced at a much younger level. And so that makes us really excited. And it does allow that collaboration for teachers. So it's a solid hour outside of their normal day that they get to kind of plan and work together. And I do have to give kudos to our special teachers and our reading intervention specialists who are allowing the teachers to have that time. They organize ACE Day. They're an amazing team. They do a really great job with that. So increasing the student's growth and increasing comfort with new resources, what we're doing there is we're providing lots of conversation time. Last week, we had a half-day session where teachers met in vertical teams, so a representative from each grade level met, and had a conversation around math. What does this math program look like? How does this really align with our Common Core? And what I really loved about those conversations was it wasn't so much what are we teaching, but how are we teaching it, and why are we teaching it, and how does it look different for every single student? And kindergarten teachers were giving third grade teachers input. Third grade teachers were kind of expressing frustrations that they're having from the younger grades. And so we were able to kind of connect and see gaps that were coming and kind of fixing those areas. It's really awesome to get emails from teachers, hey, can we continue doing this? This was great. I'm already doing things in my classroom that came out of that conversation. So we were really excited by that. And so we're hoping to continue that process because not only will it allow them to become more familiar with what's happening in other grades, but I think it also kind of builds the capacity of teachers. Increasing student ownership, obviously, is our district initiative. I love walking into a classroom, and it's totally silent, and all of a sudden you hear a second grader scream, and you're trying to figure out what's going on. I just met my goal! Because the students, even in second grade, are setting their own goals, and they're getting excited when they're reaching those goals. The teachers are handing back papers, the kids met their goals, and even the kids that don't meet their goals, they're helping each other. It's okay, you'll do it next time, you'll do better next time. Part of that is at PACS. The PACS we developed in collaboration with the students. And so it's really exciting to kind of see that process develop. And we're really seeing it even happening at the kindergarten level, where we're having students talking about what they want to hope to achieve and how they're going to achieve that. So to kind of help articulate this a little bit, we thought we would show you a very short clip of a kindergarten student who actually is going to be talking about this process of learning targets and goal setting. You know, we are a work in progress. But to be able to have a kindergarten student articulate exactly what she's learning, I think really kind of sets the tone for what's going to happen in the next few years. This is Lily McKinney.
Hi, Lily.
Hi, Lily.
How are you?
All right.
I'm just wondering, what you're working on today. Can you tell me what your learning target was today? So you had to do a picture. Can I see the picture? Oh, awesome. And then you had to what, right?
Cut out.
But what is this?
I am thankful for myself.
And what did you say that was called? So the text had to match the
picture.
Picture. And so, did you enjoy it? Did you have fun? Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Life of a kindergarten teacher.
That's Alex's class.
Yeah. So, what time did you want to wrap up, or do you want me to? Okay.
Did you want me?
Okay. No, I won't.
Okay, that's why I touched it. So.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Sorry. What? A couple of the things that I just wanted to highlight that I thought was fantastic was I heard a lot of teacher leadership, that teachers talking to other teachers about what they're doing in their classroom. What I know about professional development is the best professional development that a teacher can get is talking to a colleague about what great practices are taking place in their classrooms. And so there, that's that ebb and flow of getting teachers time to interact with each other, learn from each other, but then infuse new ideas, like a district initiative of student ownership of learning, that you know maybe teachers don't have expertise in, and then them learning that together and trying it and risk-taking in their classroom. So I will tell you that the administration does a lot of work around learning together, probably more than they want to at times. Any smiles or laughs? But I think what that translates into is deep, rich conversations with their teachers, and then changes for kids in the classroom. So there's a whole trickle-down effect that is really powerful once you see it. And I just want to say thank you to all the administration for the work that they do. They're committed to this process. I know, you know, I've been here 3 years now, but every year I see more and more growth as an organization towards, you know, realizing great outcomes for kids. So thank you, team. And I know some of you have to go because you have events. So any questions for them before they leave?
I just wanted to say I'm really impressed by what you guys presented today. In addition to seeing some of the growth with teachers and that kind of thing, I was also impressed by the whole child nature of a lot of what's going on. And that, you know, you're taking results from the exit surveys and implementing them, but also how that whole child approach is affecting academics too. So, you know, with the kids in elementary school helping each other out is a support network, but it's also building their capacity in an academic way. So I was excited to hear, you know, as another theme from all of the buildings. So I was very excited, and hearing these kinds of presentations for me, it makes me being on the board, it makes it rewarding for me because I see all the great stuff that's going on and I get jazzed and really excited. So thanks.
Thank you.
And then I don't want to hold you up. So.
Yep. Thank you. Now we will move into an update from Mr. Sol on the 5-year forecast.
Five-year forecast update. This is also going to be an introduction into the board discussion topic at the latter part of it, potentially allowing non-resident teachers to bring their children into the Granville schools. beginning next year. This is not a formal five-year forecast presentation. You're not being asked to vote on the new five-year forecast. That'll come in May. This is just, now that the levy's passed, now that the state funding is more or less settled, to give you just an update of where we are relative to where we were back when we did the forecast in October, and then some of the issues that we're looking at. Look at the where we are now relative to where we were. On the revenue side, you see obviously a big increase. That is the passage of the levy. You remember in October, we were not allowed to include the levy passage in the five-year forecast because it had not been voted on yet. So this is, includes where we are with the levy passage. Other than the property tax areas, you see very little difference in the forecast from where we were back in October in the other areas. On the expenditure side, a couple of minor changes. The operations director vacancy, the position being open and being filled with on a contract basis, shifted a lot of that cost from personnel services into purchase services. That's the main, you see the personnel's gone down, the purchase services have gone up, and that's the main driver of that.
Let's switch that back and forth a few more times.
Hopefully we'll have to do it one more time.
That's right. That's good.
The other, and this is really not a change, we've been planning to do the bond fund repayment that's been pending since 2009. I realized I had it in the other charges, and it really should be in a fund transfer. So while it's out of there, it's actually in another part of the forecast, so that really is not changed. For 15, what has changed from the forecast, well, the previous two graphs were the current fiscal year. The couple of things that have changed, you see in the revenue side, we have the levy passage, of course. We have the levy passage. You do see in restricted aid, there's an 18% drop. That is because of the funding change for FCCLA. The way they restructured career tech funding, FCCLA moved into the bottom category, and that is now being funded less than it was under the prior funding system. That was not, you can see it's not a lot of money to begin with. Most of the money in that category is actually from and for excess costs for special ed, or for catastrophic costs for special ed, is where most of that money comes from. Hopefully we'll get a little more than we planned from that this year because the state did quadruple the appropriation from prior years. And they basically took all the costs and prorate them down to how much money's available. Well, there's four times as much money available this year as there was in prior years. So hopefully that means they'll fund higher percentages of the catastrophic costs. We won't know that until May or June. They make those payments once a year, either at the end of May or beginning of June. So we won't know until then what we're getting.
Is FCCLA normally funded through some different mechanism?
I'm sorry?
FCCLA is normally or has been funded through some different
mechanism? We get a small career tech. You get a small amount of money for career tech. That's considered career tech. Even though we're teaching it as part of our program, it's funded through the career tech line item in the budget. And so in prior years, we've gotten about $11,000 from that. This year, it has dropped down to about $4,000 or $5,000 because of the change in the funding method for it. On the expenditure side, a lot of what we're seeing in here is the fact that the October forecast had a lot of cuts in it because we had to submit a balanced budget, and so it had the cuts assuming the levy would not pass. So this essentially has all of the restoration of what was going on. The other change that has been made in the insurance area, in the October forecast for health insurance, we were assuming a 25% increase for the upcoming school year. Based on the initial information we've gotten back, based on our current plan and our current carrier, that is actually now 32%, not 25%. So what I have done is raise that up to 32%, and to keep our spending in balance, hold the, the amount I have reserved for salaries, I reduce that. It becomes a whole package as we move towards negotiations, a whole compensation package, so it accurately reflects what our situation is right now, based on what we know. In the purchase service areas, we had if the levy passed, we had a reservation. It won't necessarily go here for initiatives or other things, like we may do like a global scholars position at the high school or something like that, was to hold back money available to do things with, additional things with the levy passing. And then there is a $25,000 increase in supplies and materials. And again, that's because as part of the cut that was assumed, that the levy failed, there would have been a $25,000 cut in materials and supplies, so that's just been restored back to a current level. So those are really the changes going forward from where we are right now. Taking a look at our operating margins and our cash balances, you see we're, again, my goal is looking out 2 years to keep us with a positive operating margin 2 years out. You can see that our margin is still growing out through 2016. You see that in the bottom line of the chart there. The highlighted in black, that essentially becomes our peak balance of the current assumptions. And you can see right now in 2017, that balance going down by about $500,000, meaning that beginning in 2017, right now, the forecast is we'll be spending about $500,000 more than we're taking in. I hope to address that over the next six to eight months as we move into the next cycle. So that hopefully as we start getting close to 2015, we can bring that 2017 number into a current balance. Projected cash flow, as I've related to you, we made it for January again. Actually ended up doing a little bit higher balance than I expected because the advance from the county was higher than I had expected it to be. So we did make it through. We've gotten our next advance. Still not completely out of the woods, but another advance is supposed to be coming next week, and that should be a pretty big one because with the taxes finally being due. So we are out of the woods as far as dealing with cash balance in January. You can see by next January that balance is expected now to be over $1 million. And it will grow from there. The following January is the property tax fully comes in. So I will not have to be coming back to you next December asking for authority to borrow, just in case in January, because then we shouldn't be facing that again. Enrollment forecast, this really has not changed much from the October forecast. You see, as of right now, we are at 2,471 kids this year. It's a letdown, just 11 from last year. It's about 20 kids better than where we thought we would be. Still not enough to keep it a flat level. We still have the challenge next year of the size. We have a very large senior class this year and are expecting the smallest kindergarten class that we've ever had, or will have for many years at least. Kindergarten registration began today. We should have a better idea by the end of the week how at least initially accurate those numbers might be. But I think even if it comes in larger than we expect by 15, even 15 or 20 kids, it's still not enough to keep us really from at least losing 50 kids next year as a net. So again, not much has changed from the prior forecast there. State share index. Now we're getting into the state aid, and this is what we sort of morph into some of the things we're going to talk about near the end. The state aid index is what percentage of the base cost the state will fund us. Right now I am projecting when all the dust settles and it's getting there from the state, we're getting close, that we're going to be at about 34.7%, meaning that a little more than one of the 57.45 per pupil that they give, that they allow to the districts. A little over a third of that will come from the state, and the rest will be assumed to come from local resources. That will be frozen for next year under law, but then through the combination of our declining enrollment and our stabilization, if not slightly increasing valuation, I'm expecting that to drop to 30.2% by 4.5 percentage points for 2016. What that means is a very large drop in the amount of aid that we would get from the state, making the assumption about the guarantee that we think is going to happen. We'll get into that here briefly later. The law for what happens after 2015 is not there. We're assuming it will reset in 16. For right now, we're assuming it'll stay for 2 years like it did this time. It may not. It may allow to recalculate every year. If it's allowed to recalculate every year, I would expect 17 will be a percentage somewhere between 16 and 18. But again, expecting to go down another couple percentage points in 18 as we still get relatively wealthy against the rest of the state. Projected state aid, you can see we're getting, yeah, this year we've gotten a very large increase in state aid. We knew we were getting that over last year. In 2015, we'll get another large increase in state aid because of what the formula, but then without a drop in, or without a change in what we think the guarantee is gonna be, where we think it'll be in 2013 levels, that our declining enrollment and our increasing valuation, again, causing that 34% to 30% drop in our state share index, is gonna cause a drop of probably $500,000 of state aid in 2016. You see, 2017, there's a slight increase. That's because of the assumption there's no recalculation. And so we have a little bit of benefit from an assumed growth in the base aid. And then it goes down again in 18. So that to the point where while the state aid will have given us about $900,000 new dollars between 2000 and 2015, by 2018, I'm projecting we'll have lost all the 50 or 60,000 of that, 900,000. So it ends up being a temporary influx of money and decrease in money. So that probably by 18 or 19, again, unless there's a change in the guarantee, with us really being funded back how we were in 2013.
And that's largely due to relative wealth driven by enrollment.
Drop, a combination of drop in enrollment, and we do have some growth in value going on. We have, you know, there's things that we know about. We have some growth this year from a little bit of Kendall property coming on. We have the TIF, you know, the Kendall TIF ending at the end of last year, so that's gonna come on this year. That's gonna make us look wealthier. We have the new Middleton development over at Weaver, you know, Reaver Road in 16. That'll come, you know, I'm projecting that's gonna come on the books in 2016. That will make us wealthier. And so we do have a couple of those things coming on making us wealthier. There's some evidence that our housing values are starting to rebound a little bit. And so.
Residential construction also adds to it. Residential construction.
And residential construction. Yeah, that is still very weak. But it, yeah, it's adding a little bit in there as well. And so those things, plus our declining number of pupils, is what's causing this to happen. And the assumption that the guarantee is going to remain in 2013. Obviously, if the guarantee becomes a prior year guarantee, so that in 2016 we're guaranteed what we got in 2015, you can see that's going to make a big difference in what happens. I don't think that's what's going to happen. Does that mean it's not going to happen? No. Obviously, we don't know and won't know until July of next year, June or July of next year, what that's going to be.
How does the 15 number compare to prior, before 2013? Like around
it
8,
is,
9, or 10?
From just state aid, it's going to be a little bit higher than it was. But remember, at the same time, we were getting over $700,000 of reimbursements on tangible personal property. and that's gone now.
Right.
So this piece of it is probably a little bit higher than where we peaked out before the recession here, but in aggregate, when you take into account the tangible property, we're probably $600,000-$700,000 below where we were in fiscal 10 in aggregate aid from the state. Okay, so as we start to transition, fiscal goal, as we, you know, we talked about this back at the October 4th, or after the levy passed, is where I'm trying to move us to is to keep a net operating surplus 2 years out. We're there right now in 16, we're still showing operating surplus. I hope to get there in 17 as well by the time we're doing, you know, the May forecast or in, or at least next October forecast as we're getting there. Obviously, how are we gonna get there? We're gonna continue to closely watch and control spending, you know, monitor what we're spending. We're looking for ways to bolster revenue without going to the ballot. You know, the 84 vote margin that we had in November is, you know, it's kind of a signal from the community. You know, we're not really ready for you to come back anytime soon looking for more money. So the only way we can get more money is looking at ways to generate it ourselves. And really, there's only two ways that we can generate significant amounts of more of money. Add new value through development, or slow the drop in state aid by adding additional students. The two things that can get us money, more development, more value, more students. Because that's what the whole formula, the state formula is driven on right now.
Does the more value actually hurt us though, because it makes us relatively wealthier?
It does not hurt us completely.
Okay.
We do get, there is a net gain from adding value. You gain a lot more by adding students than you get by adding value right now. But you, it is still a net gain. It's not like you add the value and you lose more in state aid than you gain in new taxes. So it, you still net money, but it's really, and we'll see this in a minute. It's really the adding students where the, really where you're getting the most, the biggest bang for your buck right now.
So is it still reliant on the valuation added per student added as well that comes along with it? Or, again, I'm kind of hearing two conflicting things about adding valuation, increasing your relative wealth, right?
Yeah.
That's a bad thing, and valuation here helping.
It basically, new value, if we get new construction, the taxes from the new construction are offset by a loss of state aid.
Well, but because
but
of
not
more
complete.
Local property tax, which is two-thirds of their whatever, right?
Yeah, but yeah, okay. But it's not 100% offset. There's still a net gain from adding value. We
but
still,
it's not from the state that valuation
correct.
Comes, it's
right.
from the local tax base.
Correct.
Okay.
Yes. Basically, we gain local revenue, we lose state revenue, but net is positive. The net is positive when that happens.
The only other thing that I would say is, watching and controlling spending and having that operating surplus 2 years out, that is a good goal, and we need to continue to think that way so we can extend the levy as long as possible. But the way levy cycles are designed in Ohio, we will end up deficit spending at some point.
Yeah.
And what we're trying to do is extend that period of time as long as possible.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. The cost to educate an additional child, and this is a key concept to move into the next portion of the presentation. We spent about $9,600 per pupil. That's our spending per pupil that's reported by the state based on our spending. That's an average cost to spend. The incremental cost or the marginal cost for adding an additional student is not $9,600. It doesn't cost us $9,600 to educate the next student who walks through the door. Really, in the short term, the only additional costs are for materials and supplies. At some point, you bring in enough students, you cross a critical point where you have to start adding teachers. Yes. And at some point, you do get into that. In the short run, adding marginal students is not adding $9,600 per kid to educate. Adding one student is not going to change how much we pay for electricity or gas. It's not going to change how much Jeff and I are paid. It's not going to change how many teachers we have. Those are fixed costs, and so they do not change. What will happen is we add kids, we may get some marginal increases in cost, and our average cost will then come down because we'll be spreading a fairly fixed amount of money over a wider number of students. So again, it's a key thing to keep in mind as we're looking ahead. We'll start with development and bringing, you know, creating new development. An increase in business valuation.
I want to think about this in kind of the context of future discussion too. I see where you're coming from, right? At what point and how do you figure in kind of student-teacher ratio? So I guess my question is, what percentage of that $9,600 is directly allocable to kids, right? And what percentage is, if you will, overhead, right? Because again, administration doesn't change, the electricity doesn't change,
right,
and so forth. So of that $9,600, how much of it is directly correlatable to
students? The latest, based on the state's current measurement system, we spend about 70% of our money on direct instruction right now. Now, direct instruction is a kind of a loose term. Yeah, that includes the teacher salaries, but it also includes aid salaries. It includes our techs, you know, the tech people who are doing in the class doing instruction. So even that, some of that, while it's considered direct instruction, some of that is not variable. But the latest measure is that we spend about 7 out of every $10 on what the state defines as direct instruction.
Okay. Is that the number that you would advise us to have in our mind, or is it significantly different than that? Should we be thinking half instead is really what the number is to keep the same, again, student-teacher ratio, services to the kids on an overall basis? Is half a better number? Is 80% a better number? Or like 70% is probably as good a guess as any?
It's probably as good as any.
Okay.
At this point. All right, so start talking about a little bit about development and business and residential development. A 1% increase in business property from new construction. So we get one, something moves in, someone does something, an expansion, it adds 1% onto our business base. That yields about $18,000 of new revenue to the district. That is the difference between what we gain in property taxes and what we would lose in state aid from getting wealthier. So no change in students or anything. Add 1% in value due to new construction. It generates about $18,000 a year. So if we were to add $5,230,000 homes, which is roughly about the same amount of taxable value as a 1% increase in business property that's in the district. Adding 5 new homes in the district, and if you assume that those 5 homes have 7 school-age children in them, that would generate about $44,700 of additional revenue to the district. The net of the new taxes, net of what that making us well, that the value making us wealthier, but the additional children making us poorer, and you take all the, factor all that into account, 7 children in 5 new homes at $230,000 a home is worth $44,700 a year. If those 5 homes had 10 new students rather than 7, it's $63,000 a year. What this tells us is what's driving most of this aid is having the student in the new development, not the new development itself.
So the capital cost, if you will, and improvements in both of these cases is roughly the same?
It's roughly the same.
And so the property tax generated from the local share is the same, roughly?
The property tax is actually higher for the business development than it is for residential because the rate's higher. The property tax rate is higher in business development than it is a business property than it is on residential property. It's about 10 mils higher. Hmm. So it's not, you know, it's a fairly significant difference. But even with the business being 10 mils higher than the residential property, having the kids generates, because that's what's generating the money under the new funding system. It's making us poorer. So not only getting, again, when we add kids like that, not only getting funding for those 7 or 10 kids, we're getting additional money for every one of the other 2,470 kids that we are educating already. And that's the new funding system. It's kind of a different mindset than, different dynamic than we've had in the past.
It's so weird because, I mean, if you think about it, 10 new students gives us $63,000. So that's $6,000 per kid more.
Yep.
Right? When the state only gives us $2,000 per kid.
That's right.
Right.
Because
they only give us 30% of 5,700.
They do. But what happens is when we add those 10 more kids, we have gotten relatively poorer. And so, yes, we've gotten $2,000 per kid for each of those 10 kids. So we've gotten $20,000 that way, but we've gotten $43,000 for the other 2,470 kids because we're poor.
Because that percentage goes up.
Because that state share percentage goes up.
So even if you look at the 70% of our $9,600 that's direct instruction, right? It's like a little profit center to poor kids. Maybe this one's in the next discussion.
Yeah, it's a really different dynamic than what it's been in the past. It's a very different way of thinking about it.
Which is going to be a very difficult concept to explain to the public in a way that is understandable, because it is such a departure from the previous funding process.
And a whole different mindset for like school districts across the state. And we've got such a huge leg up in our understanding of this thing. I think this model was put in play without much like thought about what consequences would be,
right,
and how that's going to impact dynamics amongst districts and so forth.
Right.
Right. And we're just getting the long-term implications.
Yeah.
I don't think are
Do you foresee a lot of districts going to open enrollment to take advantage of this?
Open enrollment does not change this dynamic. Open enrollment, and you do open enrollment, you actually get more money, other ways of getting the students in than through open enrollment, because the open enrollment does not affect your state share percentage. You get a flat, right now, you get a flat $5,745 for each kid you take in through open enrollment. You see, through this method, we're getting more than that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's not opening. Yeah, you open enrollment is a different issue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a different way of calculating.
I want to be very clear that we are not advocating open enrollment.
I understand.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that wasn't where my question was headed.
I know exactly.
Yeah. I just.
How does the dynamics of, and maybe you have more slides you should have.
Yeah.
Are there a couple more slides to get into?
There is.
Discussion yet?
We're going to get into the discussion, which ties directly into this, of allowing teachers to bring their children into the district.
Okay, well, the question then. So how does the dynamics of having students who live in our community but currently attend either private or charter schools coming back into our district, does that change our relative wealth?
It's different. If a private school, if a kid is going to Newark Catholic,
okay,
and decides to come back here, that makes us poorer and gets us more money because that kid is not in our ADN, in our enrollment right now, counting towards our relative wealth. If the kid is going, say, doing ECOT, online, doing the online school, and resides there, that child is counted right now in our ADM. So we're already getting credit for that child in our relative state share. But what's happening is right now, we're getting $2,000 from the state for that kid. But then we're having a subtraction of $5,745 from the state that's going to ECOT to educate that kid. What we recapture in that case is not the kid coming back, we recapture the $5,745 that would then not be deducted.
Right, but it doesn't change our relative wealth.
It does not change our relative wealth. Not community school or open enrollment kids do not. Private or homeschool kids do.
Homeschool kids do.
If a homeschool kid is, child is being homeschooled right now, decides to come to the district, that child goes into our counts and makes us poor.
Because they're not currently in our
ADM. Community school kids going to community school, or the handful that we have open enrollment, going to other schools for open enrollment, they are in our ADM right now, and we have a deduction for them out of what we get from the state. Them coming back, we recapture the deduction. We don't get poor.
Just to kind of some numbers, do we know how many community school, private school, and homeschool kids are
in? We have about 35, 36 kids going to community school. We have 16 or 17 that are open enrolling. Going to one of our surrounding schools through open enrollment. They've chosen to go to Newark or Lakewood or wherever. Or in a couple of cases have been placed over there, or Heath or whatever. We've got 16 or 17 kids who are doing that.
And that doesn't impact our relative wealth.
That doesn't impact our relative wealth. What it does do is we have to give 57.45.
Right?
We lose 50. The state takes 57.45 away from us and gives it to Newark for each kid that we have going to Newark schools.
Okay. And then private.
I do not know how many. I don't know how many kids are going to private schools right now. Do you know? It's something I can look. I think it's on one of the reports I can look up online, but I don't know the number off the top of my head. That are both private and homeschool.
Yeah, we have. I mean, we have.
It's probably 40 or 50 kids or something like that. I remember seeing data that the total number of our resident kids who are not being educated by us is somewhere right around 100 kids. If you add together community school, open enrollment, private school, and homeschool. That number sounds familiar.
Yeah.
Around 100 kids. Which again, when you think about our size, that's a pretty small number. It's a very small percentage. It's just a couple percentage points of our total potential enrollment. You look at other districts, and ones that I've seen where I've seen as low as they're educating 58% of the kids who potentially could go to the schools. 42% of their potential students are going somewhere else. For us, I think it's about 3 or 4%.
But this change in legislation has significant implications relative to those 50 rough private and homeschool kids that are not in our schools.
It does make a difference if they come back.
$6,300 a piece of paper, right?
Hmm?
So,
That includes, there's some property tax in there, but it's about $6,000, $6,100 probably. It could be more.
Right.
You're already getting the property tax from them because they're already living here.
Right.
Okay. Adding children of non-resident staff. Take a look first, the law around it. The revised code has a provision that allows us to essentially allow outside people to come in here with paying tuition. It's not open enrollment, it's a tuition-based thing. We could open it to anybody. We could say, you can come here if you're willing to pay the tuition the state calculates that you were gonna pay. That's not what we're advocating. There's a second provision that says if you allow your staff members to bring their kids under that provision, you are not allowed to charge them tuition. So we are not allowed to charge them tuition even if we wanted to. The exception being is if they wanted to bring in a kindergarten student, they wanted to do an all-day program, they would have to pay the same as a resident parent. So we're not allowed to charge tuition. This is different than open enrollment. This is not an open enrollment. There are some districts that have an open enrollment policy, and the kids, staff members come in under the open enrollment policy. That's not what this is. And because of the non-open enrollment, the way this is as students come in here of staff, they count in the calculations as if they lived here. So they become students that go into the calculation of our state share index. So the students that come in, if we were to allow this, make us poor. And so again, we've already been through the explanation of what happens when you get poor. We did a survey of staff, asking them, given the choice, then we asked the non-resident staff, given the choice, and that should say non-resident staff, not teachers, that's my fault. It's the whole staff, not teachers. I feel bad, I told Jeff to make sure it said staff, and then I left something in that said teachers.
But remember, food service and custodial maintenance are not part of what's considered our staff because they are not our employees.
Yeah.
Just for reference.
So and the survey was of all staff, not just teachers. About two-thirds responded to the survey. You can see the results ranging anywhere from yes to no and various different iterations in between. The ones who said yes, they would definitely do it. There were 9 respondents who said yes. 6 of them, they had 6 kids who would be coming in the upcoming school year, and there were 7 who had kids they would bring in but are not of school age yet next year. And then you see where they are, where everyone else ranks in there. The bottom part of this is if all 19 kids that said anything but no, so even the ones, the 4 who said where it was probably not, if all 19 of them came in next year, you can see the split among grades, that no more than 3 are in any one grade. They're spread out all the way from K through 9. It's unlikely to add any kind of burden at any grade level that would cause us a staffing issue. All our staffing ratios look good right now for next year. That's really not an issue where we would have to bring on staff to accommodate this kind of change. If all 19 kids were to come in, we would generate, next year we would generate nothing. And that's because on the new state funding formula, we are on the cap, which we are already going to be funded at the maximum the state is allowing us to be funded at next year. But the year after that, when we are no longer on the cap, I am estimating we would generate about an additional $130,000 from those 19 kids, and that's about $6,800 a kid. So again, you think about what we showed earlier, it's about $6,800 a kid. If all 19 of them came in, as I said, the potential class, the projected class sizes have no trouble absorbing that cohort of children at this point. Well, so what's changed? This has not been something that has been talked about. What has changed? Part of it is what's happening with district enrollment. We're projecting right now by the 15-16 school year, we're going to be down 200 kids from our peak enrollment in 9-10. We're already down 100 kids from that peak enrollment. If you take a look at the graph here, the blue bars are the projected enrollments by building for the 15-16 school year. The red bars are the estimated building capacity. And you can see we are under capacity in each of the 4 buildings, much more so at the lower grades than the upper grades. We've seen that in the enrollment numbers, why that's the case. And that's the difference. We're really not running up against the building capacity. Back 10 years ago, when the studies were done and when the board took placed the levy to build a 5th building on, put that on the ballot, the projection on that study was that by I think it was this school year, that we would have more than 3,000 kids in the district. So we would be 400 kids over capacity. Obviously, that has not happened. And now we are looking at being more than 300 kids under capacity. It's a different dynamic. With the new funding formula and the capacity of the buildings, we can bring more students in. It is not going to cause a problem, capacity problem in the building, at least not in the near term, certainly. It would take a pretty major housing turnaround to start bringing kids back in at the rate we were bringing them in 10 and 15 years ago. That's one of the things that has changed. The other, we're looking at a $900,000 loss in revenue from the state beginning after next year, probably over anywhere for three to five years, losing $900,000 based on the assumptions that we're making right now and what we think is going to happen. The only way to stem that is, again, we need to either add students or expand the tax base or both. That is the only way to, either that or, I guess, lobby hard for a better guarantee. That's outside of that. We can't control that. We have more control over this. And if we're going to try and offset the loss of that money and look for ways of making the levy last longer, if we're going to be proactive in doing that, these are the ways of doing it.
If there is a guarantee that continues, then this kind of discussion is a little bit not relevant, right? Because we will continue to get funded at prior year levels.
We could.
Relative wealth is not as.
If we were to get.
Because
yeah.
The calculated number would be below what we would
right.
Get anyway.
And then the question becomes, okay, so is this a bad idea that if we got the guarantee? Well, and now we're not getting additional money, but also we realize we're going to have $500,000 more money that in 15-16 than we're expecting mm-hmm. right now if we allow our teachers to come in. We can still absorb. It's not going to hurt. The other question to come up is, what if this funding formula changes again?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a legitimate question, given that we've now had, four formulas in the last 5 years or something like that. It's a legitimate question, but it's kind of hard to see a set of circumstances where having more students than we're currently projecting is going to be a harmful thing. It may not be as helpful as it is under the current formula, but it's hard to see where it becomes harmful. That we have more kids. That would be if we were approaching the capacity of our buildings and not losing students, that's one thing. If we're trying to hold the line for the students that we are losing and keep those numbers from going down, it's really kind of hard to see a formula or a set of circumstances where it really becomes a bad thing to have more students.
So that brings us to the board discussion topic, which is just general thoughts about what you just heard as a general concept. Let me frame the conversation a little bit more intentionally as well. I think what we want to demonstrate as a board and as an administration is that we are going to do our due diligence and surface a lot of ideas to you as a board and to the community, potentially make this levy last as long as possible. That's what the community is expecting from us. Therefore, we are going to have these types of conversations to get at what is it that we want to do potentially as a change in policy. From a change of policy perspective, this is a board discussion at this point. If we were going to move ahead with a board policy change, it would be at least 2 months. We We would do a first reading at the next meeting and a second reading with a final action at the second. So understand we have a couple of months to surface the idea, discuss it with the constituents that we all report to, so to speak, and then come back as a governance team and make a decision. So I just wanted to frame that, but I think it's an important concept that we be able to have these types of conversations about potential revenue generating opportunities and have a thoughtful discussion about them. So with that, I will turn it over to you.
Thanks for bringing it. Again, it's really just driven by your deep insights into the model, but I think we're all just kind of getting our eyes opened up to appreciate the clear explanation and delineation of it. I guess relative to kind of staff kids, I think it'd be fantastic to have, you know, that set of kids here in the district, because, you know, I feel like they're sort of part of the family already, you know, and I think that'd be really a great addition to the district. And so I feel there's probably a good fit there. Not like I know all these kids or whatever, but my sense is there's just a nice fit. But I think, you know, I don't want to do it sort of for financial reasons only, and I feel a little strange having that being, you know, hanging over us to some extent. But it does have real financial implications, which sort of seem clear based on the calculations now, but sort of unclear based on what's going to happen, right? So I think it's an interesting suggestion, and really it's probably positive, but my confidence in the model not changing a lot pretty often, right, makes me not want to jerk around our policy, right, trying to chase a model that's going to also be dynamic, right? And I'm not sure if that's ever stabilized. Maybe it's just always in this mode and you just got to go with it and see what happens, right? But I feel kind of funny trying to chase this policy with our enrollment things, right, based on who knows what's happened, right? I mean, the guarantee thing is a big one, right? If the guarantee continues as it has in the past, then that's a big difference. And not like, again, adding a couple of three kids per grade looks like it makes a difference. It's not going to really change our staffing, but, you know, thinking it in an overall context, right, it still does have some implications to student-teacher ratio and potentially, you know, how much you can potentially each kid or differentiate or whatever the resources are that are allocated there. And it's only a portion of that overall cost that's even direct allocated to kids, but there's some implication of that as we increase the enrollment. At some point, you have to add a staff member somewhere, right?
Or not eliminate a staff member that we would be otherwise eliminating.
Correct. Or to be happy with the student-teacher ratio going up, right? I mean, that's another implication of it necessarily that has to come with that. So I see things on both sides, and I don't have a definitive position, but really appreciate you bringing it, and I think that we'll get some interesting feedback. But, you know, it seems like it's probably a great group of kids that would fit in our community very well here, right? So I think that's a nice fit, you know, certainly compared to what an open enrollment kind of situation would do. And the financial numbers seems like they're in line and right and encouraging. But the stability of it, and I think they're kind of policy on because it looks like it'll make sense and then pull it off because the state changed their mind. And, you know, how many times does that happen? But that's just my initial thoughts.
Are there, from what your discussions at the state level, are there any discussions that this dynamic is happening with this model, or are there any inclinations that things might change? Or, I mean, you had said didn't seem like it, but just, you know, from
a
what
a lot
you
of said, that, I mean, I think a big piece of that will be decided this November with the outcome of the gubernatorial election. I think that if the governor is reelected, there's a much higher chance that this model or something resembling this model will stay in place at least for four more years. If the governor were not to be reelected, there's a real good chance we could be back into a bridge formula again. That freezes funding at the prior year for the new governor to come up with his new funding plan 2 years from now, which is actually getting kind of tiresome at this point.
Yeah.
Changing, having bridges and a new school funding formula every 4 years. But there's no guarantees in any
of course
this.
Not.
The way the political system is right now, it's much more, well, if the other guys did it, it must be bad. And where the foundation system that was in place, really was in place for about 25 years. The system that that Governor Strickland replaced in 2009, 2010. So it was a state, he may not have liked the system. There were all kinds of flaws in the system, but it was stable. And that's obviously not the dynamic of where we are right now. There are no guarantees in any of this. It makes it a harder discussion and a harder decision.
It was a good report, Mike. It was very detailed, very thoughtful, and highlights the challenge going forward. And I think, Jeff, as you said, the community expects, and certainly the board expects, that we'll extend this levy as far as possible and continue to be vigilant about controlling expenses. To me, what it reveals in the two options you put out there, which are, one, trying to slow the decline in student enrollment, and two, trying to expand the tax base, the valuation. Despite the fact that there are no guarantees, despite the fact that there will continue to be uncertainty, I think uncertainty is the norm, the new norm. I think the options are to do nothing or to do something, and I favor doing something and being as proactive as we can, because we know what the demographic trends are, we know what the declining enrollment trends are, and we know the results from that. You've illustrated that. We know what the current state formula is, or think we know what it is and what the result is from that. And so I think it's incumbent upon us as a community to look at these options and to discuss them and consider how we would, implement them. And I think we have to do both. And, certainly the expansion of the tax base, it's not a school board issue. It's a community issue. And one that, I know there are a number of folks in the community who have talked about that. There are some indications that there will be some coalitions formed to try and address that. Certainly we should be supportive of that. If it's positive increasing of the tax base and benefiting the community. But I think what we have to look at here is how we can slow the decline. I agree with Thomas. I suspect that it would be, additive to the district in terms of the quality of the students. I certainly would be interested in the thoughts from staff, but I would think it would be viewed as a positive from a staff position. Whether that's viewed as an additional benefit of the job, whether it helps in the recruiting and retention process, my belief is it would, but I'd like to hear more about that. And that would be beneficial, I think, as well. And so I think we have to, I would certainly favor looking at this and giving it as much thought and consideration as possible. There is always some risk that the formula changes and we end up with a bigger challenge. I tend to agree with you, Mike. I don't think it would get worse. It just may not be as beneficial. One thing I think we have to do is just make sure we don't flip-flop from year to year. It's not fair to students. It's not fair to teachers. It's not fair to the community. So we have to find a path that we can be comfortable with and pursue it. But I, based on what we've seen tonight, I certainly would be in favor of continuing this discussion and soliciting input from all members of the community and the staff.
I think similarly to Russ, in the sense that, there's things that we can control and there's things that we can't. And this happens to be one area that we can have some control over.
And I think we have some responsibility to, you know, look for additional revenue, although not every, you know, thing that's presented to us is an appropriate necessarily thing to take on. But a nice benefit of this is that it is beneficial to the staff. And so that's, I think that's a plus-plus or a win-win. And so I would definitely be interested in continuing the conversation. And I agree with Russ that we're all in or we're not in. So we don't want to flip-flop back and forth, like, you know, 1 year you're in, 1 year you're out. So either it's you're in, we do it, or we don't. So I do agree with you on that as well. So, but I think it's a very intriguing option because it is something that we can have some control over.
I guess what strikes me is the potential human benefit for the families who would be involved, but also the potential downside of that would be if teachers are no longer employed, it would be disruptive to their children's education because we would not offer that on a tuition basis. And I would be deeply concerned if the political advantages were to disappear. Again, it could be disruptive to the children involved. That would be my biggest concerns.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about that as something that we would need to think about in terms of the policy. What happens if the teacher leaves?
What you can do under the law is you can allow the student to stay here, but they would have to, the parent would have to then pay the state mandated tuition.
Okay.
So, and it's not cheap.
Would that require us to offer open enrollment to others?
Again,
okay. This is, would just be sort of grandfathering existing.
It would not be open enrollment. Again, that tuition program is something, in essence, you almost operate the district in a way like a private school.
Right.
And the tuition level is actually set by the state.
Right.
57 to 45?
No, it's higher. It's based on our, essentially, it's based on our average property. On our property tax revenue per pupil. It's actually probably somewhere around $8,000.
Does that affect our relative wealth?
And the kid would count as one of our students. And so, yeah, so basically you would generate $14,000 or $15,000 for a student that came into the district that way. But you have limited control. Now, if at a cost of $8,100 out of the family's pocket, probably would have it is going to be self-limiting
right.
in some ways. And you can limit it and say, you know, if you're going to do it and say, we only want them in grades 1 through 5, and we'll take up to 5 in each grade, or something like that. But that's way outside.
Sure.
Of it. But you could set it up so that if a teacher was no longer employed here, they could keep the child here, but they would have to pay the tuition that is waived by state law when they are a staff member here.
How long has that state law been in effect?
A long time.
Really?
I couldn't give you a date, but it's been around for, I think, for a long, long time.
I can remember a discussion with a previous iteration of the board about a teacher who wanted to enroll a child, a non-resident child, and offered to pay the tuition and was not allowed to. I don't remember that law being cited at the time. Just curious.
The board could have permitted it, but what you could not have done was limited it to
that child,
that one person. You either have to have the policy, and again, you can do it by saying, if the kid was coming in the 7th grade, you say, all right, we're going to have tuition, we're only going to allow one in 7th grade, and that probably wouldn't fly very well.
But you can do it for all staff, right? Mm-hmm. You can do it for all staff.
This you have to do for all staff. Once you go to the tuition thing, you have to allow anybody, not you can't restrict that just to staff. you would have to allow anybody who is non-resident come in. You know, again, with the restriction, you could put restrictions on the number of kids and the grades you take in. But if you said, okay, we're going to take five first graders, and you got eight first graders signed up who want to come in and pay the tuition, you either have to decide by lottery or first come, first serve. You can't decide which five of the eight would best fit. Mm-hmm. You have to either do it on first come, first serve or lottery, but you can't make an exception for one person. Right. It's a board policy.
Right.
What's the timing by which decisions or policy changes could be made relative to the timing of potential political changes? I mean, there's a November thing, and I'm not sure if much is going to happen there or not, but the biggest change is the guarantee, and if the guarantee continues or not, and if there's continues to be a guarantee of the prior year, right, then the implication of relative wealth is not relevant because we would be so far below what the guarantee says we are. So, I mean, when does that happen? Guarantee continuing or not happening? June or July of next year, right? So what's the timing by which this, I mean, we would need to implement a policy if we were to want kids here next year, this year, right?
The one rule about this is that it has to take effect at the beginning of the school year. You mm-hmm. cannot implement it during the school year. Mm-hmm. That is in the law. So you really have to have it in place either for the upcoming year, or if you chose not to the upcoming year, the following year, sometime in the following year. You couldn't do it in October and let the parents bring their kids in during that year and move them during the year.
And the enrollment is always, like, so there wouldn't be any change for the funding next year because?
Because the state share percentage is frozen. And we're capped. And because we're capped. We're allowed to have 10.5% growth, and right now the projection is if there wasn't the cap, we'd have probably about 12% growth. And so we're gonna be about 1.5% on the cap. So adding students can't make us go get more next year.
So what if a teacher were hired partway through the year? Could their children come partway through the year?
No.
Not because the policy would have been in place, they could, right?
The student has to start. The student has to start at the beginning of the year. It's in the law. The student cannot come in the middle of the year. So if we hired a staff member in the middle of the year, the staff member would have to wait until the beginning of the next school year to bring their child in.
So, I mean, clearly the biggest financial impact of a decision like this comes in the 15-16 school year, which is when we either lose $900,000 of revenue or don't.
Well, we won't lose all $900,000.
No, but basically.
But we use a big chunk.
Yeah.
We'll lose about $500,000 is what I'm projecting right now.
And a decision on policy here could have an influence on that change in revenue.
That is correct.
But we could still benefit from a change if we didn't act this year, but acted next year.
Right.
Yes. And we know more about the guarantee, although we might not know anything more in June.
You would be making a pretty late decision.
No, by meaning like the guarantee, like, I mean, but they may not change anything about the guarantee in June this year, but they could change it.
They won't change
it. They won't change this year. It'll be next year.
It'll be in the next budget. The guarantee is normally set in the budget for 2 years.
And we'll probably hear a little bit about it before then because it's a pretty big deal, right? And so you'll get some senses. I mean, there have been a few kind of comments.
Yes, and no. It's a big deal, but it's not a very well understood big deal. And so, you may or may not hear it. Yeah, if you just remember, the fact that they kept the guarantee at 2013 level for 2015, we didn't figure that out until August. It was changed right at the last minute in conference committee, and it was such a small change, we didn't figure it out until we got into temporary law, and it was in August before we realized that they had done that. And even though
capacity in the funding model is just that way. I mean, there's just huge implications of enrollment and relative wealth and guarantee and caps and so forth, right, that makes it, you know, very complex, right? So I'm very thankful that we have someone to show us through that process, for sure.
Definitely.
We have a huge leg up to you know, all the other districts in the state to some extent. But it seems like that huge swing comes, you know, in the 15-16 school year, where the implications of this decision financially have a pretty big weight, potentially. Right? $6,000 times 20 kids or whatever, right?
Well, let me wrap up this board dial by just saying you've touched on a lot of points that we've discussed internally, specifically the volatility of, or the unknown aspect of the funding formula moving forward. What is in the best interest of kids was a big topic of conversation. The recruitment aspect to future employees, given that the fact that our housing market is an expensive market in general to live in. So you've touched on quite a few things that we've discussed, and I think, you know, there's never going to be a clear answer, but we are going to have to place our error on one way or the other. So I think we're going to have to figure that out as we move forward. Or, you know, we have three options. We can delay the conversation, we can change the policy, or we can say no, we're not interested. So that concludes that conversation. Thank you. That moves us
to public to public comment. If there's anybody who would like to address the board, please come to the podium. You can speak for 3 to 5 minutes, state your name and address, and let us know what you're thinking about. Would anybody like to address the board at this time? Seeing as there is none, we will move on to board reports. I'll start. This week, neither of the House or Senate committees met or voted on anything, but various bills are at various stages in the process. House Bill 113, which is would grant the authority of boards of education to adopt a policy to excuse high school students from physical education if they are in a club sport, rather than a varsity sport, a school-sponsored club sport, to get out of gym. That was recently voted out of the House and sent to the Senate for consideration. So that's House Bill 113 has now been sent to the Senate. House Bill 193 is legislation seeking to revise the high school diploma requirements. It was voted, and that's mostly around delaying the phasing out of the OGT and the adoption of other electronic assessments. And that was voted out of the House chamber on January 22nd and now heads over to the Senate for committee hearings. So that has to go through the Senate hearings before it reaches the Senate floor. House Bill 413 is the legislation that seeks to halt the implementation of the park assessments. The bill has been referred to the House Education Committee, so it's still at the House. It's not been voted out of the House yet. House Bill 416 is the calamity days, which we've all been reading about, I'm sure. And that was that's to add 4 days to the calendar, is that right? 4, yeah, 4 calamity days, also allowing schools to add up to 30 minutes to the end of a school day to try and make up for days more than the current 5 days missed because of, well, I guess whatever reason, because it hasn't been all snow for us. So that was placed on the House session calendar for February 12th, so it's not yet out of the House. And once it gets passed out of the House, it will go to the Senate for consideration. And then Senate Bill 229 is the legislation that's seeking to modify requirements under OTES, the Ohio Teacher Evaluation System, to make it a little bit more flexible for us in evaluating teachers. And that bill has been voted out of the Senate and has been referred to the House Education Committee, but there has been no changes on that since the 31st of January. So quite a few things going on, nothing decided. And then CTEC has had some interesting things going on. This is actually National Career Technological Education Month, and so CTEC, I'm sure, will be doing something we haven't heard yet. I
don't meet there until the end of the month, but it is a month to celebrate career and technological education. Kind of an exciting collaboration happening between the cosmetology students and a program called Merity's Way. Merity's Way provides wigs for women who have cancer and have lost their hair from chemo treatment. And they're collaborating with the students at CTEC, the cosmetology students. So the students will care for the wigs and house the wigs at CTEC. And then if there is a woman who needs a wig, they can come in and get a free appointment with a cosmetology student and a free styling. So that these students are, you know, giving back, but also still continuing their training, which I think is exciting. And then also the architecture, engineering, design students are going to get to use 3D printers. They're collaborating with the Heath Newark Licking County Port Authority, who has leased two of these printers to CTEC and actually one to the works. And so those students are going to get the experience using a 3D printer. And the costs related to any of the activities is being covered by the Port Authority for 6 months. So that's kind of exciting. And then recently in January, the ABLE program, which is the Adult Basic Literacy Education, had their graduation. About 33 students came. There was a total of 62 people who had passed their GEDs between July and December. I got to it. This is the first time they've done a mid-year graduation. I went to the one last May. And it's actually a very moving ceremony, very exciting. You know, these students work really hard, you know, to come, you know, some of them coming back from pretty horrific situations to come back and get their GED. So, yeah, they had 33 students attend their graduation. And that's that. Let's see. Moving on. Katie's not here. Is there anything?
There's nothing.
Thomas?
The Granville Education Foundation concluded a great 2013 with a fall fund drive to bring funds for a good series of grants that they're out seeking now. So they've, I think, circulated and visited with staff members to request proposals for grants that they hope to fill again this year. So that's been very successful. And with the additional trustees of the Granville Education Foundation, there's been a lot of really high caliber people from across the community that have joined to kind of re-energize and start to really scrutinize a lot of the ways that they do things to make sure they're up to speed. Some of them around specifically how 501c3 charitable organizations are sort of defined and controlled. It's an area that I think there's a lot of opportunity as a district for us to understand better, because there's a lot more scrutiny going into those kinds of organizations from the IRS and other places that I think we can figure out how to bring together and educate all of our support organizations in a way that has a lot more clarity to it. Because I think that, you know, we're a little disjointed in some of the groups and how funding flows through and so forth, and there's expertise that GDF, I think, can help. That benefit just to bring a lot of groups around the same table and communicate together. I don't know what the formal plans for that are and so forth, and there's some discussion specifically with GEF about what kind of category they are, but I think those things will sort themselves out, and from that hopefully we'll have a clear model by which, you know, we can, you know, work with all our support organizations. So GEF is great, re-energized by a bunch of new folks. We have a whole lot of people there at the meeting. It feels good to have so many in our community willing to dedicate their time to it, as well as, you know, we're very gracious for all those in the community that have chosen to give specifically to grants that will ultimately be going out to students at the end of this year.
What's the timeline for the grant process? Do you know?
It's a spring grant.
It's spring. Okay. So the deadline, I mean, it's just starting.
It's a spring break, I believe.
Yeah.
Okay.
Spring break. Right for spring break, I believe. I'll double check.
Right, so I really hope we get a lot of great grants. I mean, we just really hope that lots of staff members come up with fantastic, creative, new ideas for things that can help enhance education in the classroom. And I hope the GEF can be creative with finding ways to resource all of those.
Amy, anything from the Granville Foundation?
The Granville Foundation's grant cycle application period just closed. The grants committee met Saturday. The foundation hasn't gotten their recommendations yet, or hasn't met to discuss the recommendations yet. But it should be coming this month.
This month, okay.
Yeah.
Levy committee, the levy committee has left me in the dust. I need to. The group is continuing to do some work, both in generally in support of schools and in particular in preparation for educating folks about the upcoming levy. And Jay Snyder has agreed to chair that effort, and I think that is tremendous. He'll be fantastic in that role, and I know that there are others who are considering leadership opportunities, probably too soon to disclose them now, but others who will as well, and I know that the group, Jay, and a number of volunteers there can use a lot of support. So I'll bring more detailed news to our next meeting.
So moved.
Second. Go ahead.
Any questions or discussion? Nope.
No.
Take the roll.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Mr. Janice.
Aye.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Dr. Gorman.
Aye.
Thank you. Item 10.2 is an unpaid leave of absence for two of our employees.
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? Questions? Take the roll.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Mr. Janice.
Aye.
Dr. Gorman.
Aye.
10.4 is a feedback from the action item last board meeting, which is recognizing the bus drivers as chaperones. We have three more to add to that.
So moved.
Second.
Questions? Take roll.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Mr. Janice.
Aye.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Dr. Gorman.
Aye.
Next is the approval of a grant that was granted by Beacon and Society for the high school.
So moved.
Aye.
Dr. Gorman.
Aye.
Okay. The next item, 10.06, is our two overnight field trips. The first one, I just wrote a check for myself. My daughter will be heading down to the Youth and Government Conference in Columbus. And then the second is the High School China Leadership Summit for 23 students. It will take place in March. And I will tell you that Mr. Bernat went to China for a long weekend and tried to recover for another week, but we are very excited about this opportunity for our students.
So moved.
Second. Go ahead.
Discussion? Questions?
It's fantastic.
Yeah, this is really cool.
Yeah.
That's a great point. Both of these are funded by parents. The China trip was 4,200. Mm-hmm. And that's 9 days in Shanghai and Beijing with a lot of great things to do in between.
And so in April, we'll hear from them?
Actually, they are going to do a student presentation in May.
In May?
Yes.
Okay.
That is part of their credit process.
Okay.
For giving high school credit for the trip.
A presentation?
Yes,
here.
To the board.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Look forward to that.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Mr. Janice.
Aye.
Dr. Corman.
Aye.
Okay, the next item, 10.07, is a contract or a statement of work with the ESCCO, which is the Educational Service Center of Central Ohio.
Second.
She can't get away from us.
No, she can't. And I will tell you, it is a blessing to have her on board mm-hmm. and helping with all the little things that take place on a regular basis that nobody ever thinks about until, you know, there's not anybody around who can do those things.
Thank you.
Yeah. Happy to have you back.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Mr. Janine.
Aye.
Dr. Cornyn.
Aye.
The next item is 10.08, the Director of Human Resources and Operations job description. And once I get a motion, I'll talk a little bit about that.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. As you know, with the departure of Mr. Dilbo, we went through a process of revising that job description to add a layer of human resources systems to the job description and actually tasks to the job description. So what we tried to do is take the current operations and then what a human resources director would do and blend the two into one position. Realizing that as the school district grew in over the last 10 years, there really were opportunities to add systems in place from hiring and maintenance of records and all of the systems that go into the hiring process, recruitment, selection, retention process for employees. There are a lot of little things that need to take place on a regular basis in order to get the recommendation to the board for hiring. There are a lot of little things that take place on a regular basis. So what we try to do is blend those, but really make sure that people applying for the position knew that there was going to be an emphasis on human resources as well as operations. The operations might be taking a little bit of a back seat because we do outsource a couple of areas that are operational in nature, meaning food service and custodial maintenance. However, it's going to be a balanced position. And some people might look at the job description and say, we're looking for Superman. But I will tell you, a wise person once said, when I asked, well, what are you looking for? He said, I want everything. So now I'm in that position. I want it all.
Yeah, it's a great opportunity to bring somebody in, right, to be a real contributor to the leadership team. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, fleshing out the description like that makes sense. And I think that you need to be a little bit flexible to who we get, right? Because it's as much about the character and the caliber of the person within the organization as it is the specific capabilities. And I think there's enough latitude in that position description to bring in a fantastic person, right? So hopefully this enables you to, you know, really help to build your leadership team with the best that we can get.
What's the, your post is if we approve it?
Tomorrow.
Yes. And is it appropriate to talk about the timeline that we're looking at now?
We can, we will be accepting applications, intents, references until March 7th. And then we'll go through a paper screening process. We will have a committee that will have staff, community, administration, a part of that process. Very similar to processes that we've used in the past. But really trying to get as many people involved in the selection process that have a vested interest in that.
Yeah. Mr. Janice.
Aye.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Dr. Cornyn.
Aye.
All right. 10.09 is the 2014-15 school calendar.
So moved. Second.
And just so people are aware, this calendar mirrors the calendar that is in place currently. We believe that that is a calendar that is advantageous to our students. If we don't have a bunch of snow days that take them out of school, but it is a good base calendar that we think maximizes student interest. The other aspect to the school calendar is minimum hours. Next year, we may look at, you know, revising the calendar in some ways, but really, statute says you should keep your calendar pretty consistent to what it is currently. So that's what we've done.
Discussion?
I haven't heard any complaints about the calendar this year. I think it's worked out nicely, other than the calamity days.
Yes.
Are the same number of professional development and COVID days? It doesn't seem like it's about the same.
It's exactly the same.
Yeah. Take your role, please.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Mr. Janice.
Aye.
Dr. Corman.
Aye.
Next is item 10.10, which is the Granville High School course book. Mr. Burnett provided a summary of changes to you.
So moved. Oh, do we need?
Yeah, name
okay,
motion.
So moved. Yeah.
Questions? Discussions?
Mr. Janice.
Hi.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Ms. Deeds.
Aye.
Dr. Corman.
Aye.
Okay, that moves us into our consent agenda. 11.01A through C7.
You wore you off, huh?
All right. We have the acceptance of donations and gifts. Again, it's amazing how generous our community is to support a variety of different things that we have going on in our schools, from archery to music to the college fair. We have a very generous community. We have most of our spring supplementals that are going to be approved today. I want to recommend with appreciation of service and a little regret that we will be accepting Kim Parise, our Director of Student Services, effective August 1 at the end of the school year, her resignation. And then also with regret and appreciation of service, Bethany Nguyen, who is going to retire. Just wanted to bring those to your attention.
Any other comments or discussion?
Thank you, Kim.
Thanks.
Take the roll, please.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
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 As I mentioned in the earlier presentation, we did finish January with about $435,000 of cash. It's a good thing. Because of the extra money from the county advance, the spending was mostly in line. The purchase services were quite a bit above estimate. That's because we ended up not having to hold bills as much as we did. We're expecting we would have to hold them to stay within our cash balance, so we were able to, we didn't hold some, not as much as we did last year, to stay within our cash balance. Other issues, state aid calculation deductions, those are for the most part getting straightened out. There's still updates every 2 weeks that are changing things marginally. The preschool, I guess. The state put out the preschool funding for the first time this past Friday, and how it was being funded. Some very strange things happened. It took a while, but I think I have gotten it straightened. I've only this right now. I understand what they have done, I believe, at this point. And the main thing that they have done was they, without telling anybody, prorated everybody's preschool by just over 25%. So if the calculation said you were supposed to get $100,000, you got $75,000. Now, this came as quite a surprise to everybody because there was no indication or mention that they were going to have to do this. Subsequently, as I attempted to figure out our funding, it finally, I think, determined late this afternoon that ODE has probably made a mistake. And there are a group of kids who are classified as developmentally delayed, which is a new definition that's in the code this year coming out of the budget. And by law, those kids are supposed to, there's six categories of special ed. One being the least severe, which is speech, six being the most severe, which is a lot of issues. And developmental delay is supposed, by law, is supposed to be in category two. I believe that ODE, in pulling the data out of EMIS, has taken all of the kids who are developmentally delayed and placed them in category six instead of category two, which probably explains why they don't have enough money to fund the preschool program.
He's like a financial Sherlock Holmes to find this stuff out.
So I did leave a message with someone at ODE late this afternoon, so telling him they may want to go back and look at the source of the data and see if indeed they did take all of these developmentally delayed kids and put them in category six instead of category two. And the reason I found this is when I looked at our deduction, they were deducting us for nine kids, and I finally figured out who those nine kids are, and six of them were category six. And we knew we did not have six category six kids, we only had one. And it was then we realized that the other five were coming from this code that was new this year. And so I suspect that when ODE goes back and looks at that, they will determine that, yes, they put these kids in the wrong category, and if they have done this across the state, which I would imagine is the case, because I don't know why they would do it to us and not everybody else, that they will probably magically find that maybe preschool isn't so low. They didn't underfund preschool by quite so much, if at all. So I am awaiting hearing about that here in the next, hopefully this week or so.
He's doing his own job, he's doing their job too.
Somebody asked.
Do they?
So anyway, that's where we are with preschool right now. The funding deduction that I think we will end up with is going to be less than we had anticipated it would be. I had projected it would be about $66,000 that we, primarily for the kids, handicapped preschool kids who are educated through the ESC. The current deduction is $47,000, but since that has five kids in category six who aren't really in category six, that number should go down more once they get all that straightened out. So that's the big fun issue of the day. The rest of it just shows the estimate against actual and the cash flow with the board and same. So I forgot to ask for a motion.
Yeah, we need a motion. So moved.
Second.
Any questions?
No. Report looks fine.
You can take it all, please.
Ms. Deeds?
Aye.
Mr. Miller?
Aye.
Mr. Janisse?
Aye.
Dr. Korman?
Aye.
Thank you. Item 12.02 is to create a fund for donations towards the land lab. Right now there is a fund for the money coming from the federal government to develop it. We are anticipating and have inklings of donations that will be coming. So we want to set up a fund to make sure it goes into that fund and is used for the Lion Lab.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
That'll be a treasurer's fund controlled.
It will be a treasurer. It'll be a what we call a 200 level, which is a, or 300 level rather, which is a district-driven student grant. So essentially, Jim Redding will have, you know, he'll have the budgetary authority over it, but it is within the district funds.
Thank you.
Ms. Dees.
Aye.
Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Mr. Janine.
Aye.
Dr. Corman.
Aye. Can I have a motion to enter into executive session to consider the employment of a public employee?
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Janice.